Can I go now?
Is that on?
That's all right. I'd walk right in front of it.
Turn it off.
Okay, hello, Mr. Rob.
We set aside actually for the temp time being for this particular mural. Now, you know, when we brought this in here, we're all advised that a painting is actually, you know, portraying figures that are not in motion, and a mural is about figures that are showing action or motion. And this is a mural officially. The artist who portrayed this is Mr. Charles.
Do you love him good?
Yeah. All right, well, if you'd like, we'll give him this next exhibit here, and we'll talk about it.
I'm so sorry.
I'll be the first to press.
Don't go. They're taking a picture of you. They found you.
Please take a few moments to examine its many personalized features.
What year is that pattern?
Well,
Mr. Joyle.
Okay, now I'm going to $3. This car right here, of course, you just heard described a lot of different things. He had to use some of his gifts on the ceiling, gold records. Had a shoe buffer. Now we're thinking 1950s here, 1960. $1,000 to 1960.
One of the most famous automobiles in the world. We'd like you to see the interior of the car firsthand. Purchased by Elvis and RCA Records in 1960, the car was converted into a luxurious mobile lounge by California's custom car king, George Barris. A special hand-rubbed paint job, 24-karat gold-plated trim, and a custom interior altered the Cadillac's stock appearance. The solid gold theme has been carried throughout the car.
Actually,
dark, you won't get me, Dave. Come on, Dave, and take away.
Some other articles he's performed with quite a few people worldwide, even done at First Center's up.
Studio B, Oh Lonesome Me by Don Gibson. He'll Have to Go by Jim Reeves. Only the Lonely by Roy Orbison. Kathy's Clown by the Everly Brothers. And Love is Like a Butterfly by Dolly Parton, just to name a few. What was it like at those recording sessions? Well, Studio B has been left very much like the way it was back when recording was in progress here. Take a look around the studio and you'll see a Steinway grand piano, a Fender Telecaster electric guitar and a Takamine acoustic guitar, a Showbud pedal steel guitar, a honky-tonk piano, a Hammond organ, and other instruments. In the middle of the room, against the wall, is the rhythm hut, which was installed in 1973, placed inside the rhythm hut to keep their sounds from leaking onto the microphones of the artists or other instruments. On almost any given day between 1957 and 1977, you could have come to the studio and walked in on an important session. If you had stepped into this studio early on the evening of April 3rd, 1960, you would have seen Elvis Presley sitting at the grand piano. Standing around him are four relaxed, casually dressed young men, the Harmony Quartet, the Jordanaires. They haven't started recording yet. Usually, when Elvis played an instrument on his recordings, he chose to strum a guitar, but he enjoyed playing piano very much. And tonight, as with most of his sessions, in between jokes and humorous stories, Elvis and the Jordanaires are singing Elvis's favorite gospel songs as a way of warming up for the evening's big session. Elsewhere in the studio, guitarists Scotty Moore and Hank Garland and bass player Bob Moore are tuning up and maybe working out some new licks. Tonight, as often happened with Elvis's sessions, there are two drummers on hand.
Sure.
Session drummer Buddy Harmon and DJ Fontana from Elvis's band.
Okay.
The engineer has been working with them to make sure that microphones are properly arranged to pick up the best sound from both drum kits. Rounding out the session personnel are Boots Randolph on saxophone and Floyd Kramer on piano, both hit recording artists in their own right. Floyd will take his seat at the piano when Elvis is done. By the time Elvis feels ready to sing, it's already late in the evening, probably around 9:30 or 10. Elvis always preferred to record late at night. Chet Atkins and the engineer have worked out by then the best possible microphone placement to pick up the instruments, and most important of all, Elvis himself, who had the unusual habit of moving around a lot when he sang. Chet has said that sometimes they had to have two or three microphones just for Elvis to catch all his words. Once Elvis and the guys get started, it's hard to stop. Elvis is in top form, and he has good songs to sing. After taking a break at midnight, the musicians start up again at 4 a.m. and go all the way until dawn. It's exhausting work for session pros like Buddy Harmon, Hank Garland, and the Jordanaires, who probably have been working since 10 a.m. that day with other artists in other sessions. But it's worth the trouble. It's a good session. By breakfast time, they've recorded seven songs, two of which would go on to become number one hits. It's Now or Never. And Are You Lonesome Tonight?
Music Row now?
Just have to teach you a few tricks. So hammer your mop, you look straight at my mop. shot.
Not up to
shoes off.